In this class, we are going to discuss about HTML interview questions or some short torture questions. So let's see the first question. What is HTML? So HTML stands for Hypertext Markup Language. So it contains mainly two components. First component is hypertext. Second component is markup language. So hypertext is nothing but it contains some hyperlinks. So where we can have links from one web page. Markup language means a collection of markup tags which specifies how the information is displayed. If you take B tag, then the content will be displayed in bold style. If you take I tag, then the content will be displayed in italic style. If you take header tags, then the content will be displayed in some larger font sizes. So that is about markup tags. And the second one is, what are the different types of tags? Here, the tags are mainly classified into two types. The first one is empty tag, whereas the second one is container tag. So first one is empty tag, second one is container tag. So empty tag means we can have only start element ends with forward slash next greater than. So there is no need of any end tag here. It contains only start tag, that is nothing but opening tag. Whereas container tag means we can have start tag as well as end tag. Between the start tag and end tag, we have some content. So these are the two different types of tags. So first one is empty tag, second one is container tag. So empty tag means we can have only start tag ends with forward slash. We don't have any end tag. Whereas container tag means it contains start tag as well as end tag. So between start and end tag, we have some content. We have mainly three empty tag elements: BR tag element, horizontal rule, HR tag element, and IMG tag element. And most of the HTML tag elements are container tags only. Now let's see the next question. So what is the next question? What is tag attribute? Tag attribute provides additional information about the tag element. If you take a table tag, then we have various attributes of the table tag, like border, busy color, cell padding, cell spacing. So likewise, we have several attributes. So these attributes provides additional information about the tag element. So let border is an attribute is equal to. So this 4 is nothing but border value. Next, cell padding is an attribute is equal to 4 is nothing, some 3 is nothing but attribute value. So this is attribute and 4 is nothing but attribute value. So what is the use of tag attributes here? The tag attributes provides additional information about the tag element. Now let's see the next question. What does title tag display? So we can use title tag in order to display title of the web page. The title should be placed in head section. So in head section we can use title tag. So head, title. So we have to give title here. Next, close the head. The title tag, the title should be displayed at the title bar of the browser window. So this one is nothing but title bar. Title bar. So here the title will be displayed. Let's see the next question. List any three text formatting and header tags. So we have various text formattings like tags like B tag, italic tag, underline tag, deleted tag, pre tag. So likewise, we have various text formatting tags. So by using formatting tags, we can apply some formatting features on the text. If you use B tag, then the content will be displayed in bold style. If you use I tag, then the content will be displayed in italic style. If you use underline tag, then the content will be underlined. If you use delete tag, then the content will be displayed with a line through the text. If you use pre tag, then no formatting features will be applied on the corresponding text. So that is about text formatting tags. Next, header tags. We can have 6 levels of headings, H1, H2, up to H6. H1 displays the content in largest size, whereas H6 displays the content in smallest size. So So when we use this H1 tag, then the content will be displayed in some largest font sizes, as well as the content will be displayed in some bold style. H2 displays the content relatively smaller than H1. H3 displays the content in relatively smaller than H2. So likewise. So H1 means largest heading. H6 means smallest heading. So if you want to display some main headings, then it is better to use H1 here and H2 tags. If you want to display some subheadings, it is better to use H3, H4. If you want to display some subheadings, then it is better to use H5 and H6 tags. Now let's see the next question. The next question is how to specify color using RGB combination. We can specify color directly by using the color name or by using RGB combination. So RGB stands for red, green and blue. So here we can specify as here we can use as an attribute called color attribute. Let us assume that we are using either body tag or font tag. So color is equal to, within the double quotations, hash, we can use as six values. The first two values specifies red, the second two specifies green, next two specifies blue. Here 00 means the color is turned off. So if you don't want to use that color, then we use as 00 bits. FF means the color is turned on. So if you want to use that color, then we use as FF. Let us assume that we want to use only blue color. Then the combination is 00, 00, FF. Because we want to use only blue color here. Let us assume that we want to use green color here. Then what is the combination? Green color. So hash, here we have to use hash. It represents that we are using some hexadecimal notation. 00. Zero, zero. We are using blue color. So FF 00. So here we can specify 2 power 3 colorways. So either red color or green color or blue color or combination of red green, combination of red blue, or combinations of red blue, or combinations of red green and blue color. Now let's see the next one. Differentiate between BR tag and P tag. So BR tag is nothing but break line tag. It is similar to slash and escape sequence, which we use in C language. So the content which is placed after the BR tag will be placed in the next line. So whenever we use BR tag, then the content will be placed in the new line. So let we have content like this. So body, Ramu is BR, good boy. Ramu is a good boy, a good BR boy. Next, close the body tag. Then what will happen is, first Ramu is will be printed. Next BR tag. Whenever we use BR tag, then the cursor will be placed in the new line. So the content following the BR tag will be displayed in the new line. So next a good will be printed. Next here we have BR tag. So what will happen? The content following the BR tag will be placed in the new line. So the new line will be here. Next boy will be printed. So this is the advantage of BR tag. Whereas whenever we use paragraph tag, then what will happen is a new line will be printed before the paragraph as well as after the paragraph. A blank line will be printed before the paragraph as well as after the paragraph. So BR is an empty element, whereas P is container tag element. P is, we have start tag as well as end tag, and we have some content. So BR is empty tag element, whereas paragraph is container tag element. Now let's see the next one. How do you specify a horizontal rule, a solid horizontal rule, spreading 60% of the browser window and having a width of 10 pixels? So in order to specify a rule, a line, we use horizontal rule tag. So HR tag. So what is the width here? Width is equal to 60%. So width specifies width of the rule. Like it is our browser window. So width specifies left to right. So here 60% will be taken as the width here. Next, and having a width of 10 pixels. So width is equal to, and having a width of 10 pixels. So how much percentage it is using? 60% of the browser window, and size of the pixel is 10 pixels. So size is equal to 10. Here we want to draw the rule as a solid horizontal rule. So we have to use no shade attribute here. Then what will happen is 60% of the browser window will be taken here. Next, what is the size here? 10 pixels. So pixel means a dot. So 10 pixels will be taken like this. Here we want to draw solid horizontal rule. So that's why we have to use no shade attribute. So no shade attribute will draw the rule as a solid thickness rule. If we don't use no shade attribute, then what will happen is the rule will be printed like this. A white horizontal rule will be printed. Now let's see the next question. How do you specify pre-formatted text? We know what is a pre-formatted text. The major problem with browser is if the web page contains multiple white spaces or multiple tab spaces or multiple new lines, then browser ignores all the white spaces and treats all those white spaces as a single space. So if you want to specify the content as specified in the document, then it is better to use pre-formatted tag. So pre-formatting, the name itself specifies the meaning. The content is already formatted. So pre, let the content here is like this: Ramu is a good boy. Next, close the pre. So this content is displayed in the browser in the corresponding web page as it is. Whereas if you don't use this pre tag, then what will happen? So all these spaces will be treated as only one space. All these new lines will be treated as only one space. All these new lines will be treated as only one space. And all these white spaces and new lines are treated as only one space. So that is the advantage of the pre tag. Next one, how to display images. So we will display images with the help of a tag called img tag. We know that img is an empty element. So img, the attributes of the img tag are src. It specifies URL of the image which we are displaying. Let the src here is sunset.jpg. Next, if you want, we can use this height and width. So height is equal to some 100 pixels, width is equal to some 50 pixels. Next, some alternative text, sunset image. So we can display images with the help of img tag. The attributes of the img tag are src, height, width, alt. So src specifies the URL of the image which we want to display. Height specifies height of the image. Width specifies width of the image. If you don't use this height and width attribute, then the corresponding image will be displayed with the default dimensions. Alt is equal to sunset image. Alt stands for alternative text. If the image is not displayed due to any problem, then this alternative text will be displayed in place of the corresponding image. So img is an empty element. So forward slash greater than. There is no need to use any end tag here. Now let's see the next question. How to specify an image as the background? So in order to specify an image as the background, we use this background attribute, body tag. So body background is equal to, let name of the image is sunset.jpg. So now what will happen is, next sub content, close the body tag. So sunset.jpg will be displayed as the background of the web page. So in this way we can display an image as the background. Next one, tags used for unnumbered list. So what is unnumbered list? Unnumbered list can also be called as unordered list or bulleted list. So if you want to display the corresponding items without any numbering, without any order, then we use this unnumbered list. Here the unnumbered list is created with the help of UL tag element. Each item in the list is created with the help of LI tag element. Next one is tags used in numbered list. Here we use two tags. First one is OL tag and the second one is LI tag. So OL stands for ordered list. So we can create ordered list with the help of OL tag element. Next, each item in the list is created with the help of LI tag element. Next, how to change bullet style in unnumbered list. Here, in order to change the bullet style, we use an attribute called type attribute, and the possible values of type are disk or circle or square. So disk means a small solid circle will be printed. Circle means a small hollow circle, some white circle will be printed. So square means a small solid square will be printed. So by using type attribute, we can change the bullet style here. Here the default one is disk. So if you want to use, if you want to print a disk symbol before the item, then there is no need to use type attribute here. So with the help of type attribute, we can change the disk style, the bullet style. Next one is show hyperlink definitions that provides link to an image and PDF file. So with the help of the hyperlink, so we have to navigate to a JPEG file as well as a PDF file. So less than a, href is equal to. So let us take some image file here. Let name of the image is sunset.jpg. Let the content here is sunset. Next to close anchor tag. So place this in a paragraph so that a new line will be printed before and after the paragraph. So now we have to make a link to PDF file. So less than p, less than a, href is equal to some PDF file. Let name of the PDF is some first.pdf. So let the content here is first. Close the anchor tag, close the paragraph tag. Then what will happen is this hypertext sunset and first will be displayed in blue color, and by default the text will be underlined. So whenever we click on sunset, then what will happen is sunset.jpg will be printed. Likewise, whenever we click on this first, then what will happen is the first.pdf will be printed. Okay. So next one is, can relative URLs be used to provide link to a different site? So we have two types of URLs. The first one is absolute URL and the second one is relative URL. So what is the first one? Absolute URL. Second one is relative URL. So absolute URL means we have to provide the entire path starting from HTTP to the corresponding google.com. Relative URL means we have to specify only a part of the path. There is no need to specify the entire path. So here we have to specify only google.com. There is no need to specify HTTP colon //, they are nothing but /, next www dot. So here what is the question? Can relative URLs be used to provide link to a different site? So it is not possible. So no is the answer here. In order to specify the website, we have to provide the complete path starting from HTTP to google.com. So it's not possible here. So when we can use a relative path? When the source file and the destination file are locating in the same directory, then there is no need to specify the entire path. Just the file name is enough here. But here what is the problem? Here the destination page is nothing but a website. That website is not locating in our directory. That website is residing in some other server. So we have to provide the entire path. So here what is the answer? It's not possible. We have to provide the complete path. So relative URL is not enough. We need to specify the absolute URL, the complete path. Next one is how to provide links to same section of the document. How to provide links to same section of the document. Okay. So in order to provide the link here, we use just here in order to provide the link to same section of the web page. Now let's see the next question. How to provide images as the hyperlink? So we can provide an image as the hyperlink with the help of some anchor tag element. So less than a, href is equal to, so some address, some http colon / www.google.com. Next, insert image here. So img src is equal to sunset.jpg. So this is nothing but an empty element. Next to close the anchor tag. So now what will happen is an image will be displayed here. So whenever we click on this image, then it will be navigated to google.com web page. So in this way we can provide images as the hyperlinks. So next one is, what are the HTML tags associated with table? Here in table tag, we use several tags like TR tag. So TR stands for table row, TD tag, TD stands for table data, TH tag, table header. Next one, caption tag. It is useful to provide the caption for the table. Next one is dhead. The content of the dhead will be displayed as the first row of the table. Tfoot tag. The content of the tfoot will be displayed as the last row of the table. Next one is tbody tag. So tbody means other than dhead and tfoot rows. Next one is how to specify call span. If the corresponding cell occupies more than one column, then we use a call span attribute. Let this be our table. Hi, good day. So in this example, the cell is occupying how many columns? This is the first column and this is the second column. So let's see how this table is created. Table, here we have two rows. The first row contains two cells. So TR, TD, hi, less than slash TD. So hi will be printed. Next to TD, good. So good will be printed. Next to close TR tag. Next to TR, TD. Here boy is occupying two columns. So this is the first column and this is the second column. So we have to use call span attribute here. Call span is equal to how many columns it is occupying? Two columns. So call span is equal to two here. Next, what is the content here? Boy is the content. Next to close TD tag. Next to close TR tag. Next to close table tag here. So if the cell occupies more than one column, we use a call span attribute. If the cell is occupying three columns, then call span is equal to three. Here the cell is occupying two columns, so call span is equal to two here. Next one is, what is the purpose of frame set, frame and no frames? So frame set is useful in order to provide a collection of frames and other frame sets. So frame set means a collection of frames and other frame sets. So by using frame set, mainly we can specify rows and calls attribute. So row specifies horizontal frames, whereas call specifies vertical frames. Whereas frame tag is useful in order to specify the web page to be displayed in the browser window. The important attribute of the frame tag is SRC. So by using frame tag, we can display the web page that is to be printed on the web page. Next one is no frames tag. If the browser doesn't support frames concept, then the content of the no frames will be printed. So this is about what is the purpose of frame set, frame and no frames. We use as frames concept mainly when we want to separate the browser into multiple sections, where each section can display a separate web page. Next one is, what is the purpose of method and post? So these are nothing but the attributes of the form tag element. So by using method, it specifies how the data is transmitted from the client to the server. So in order to specify that, we use this method. And the second one is the action. So what is the use of method? It specifies how the form data is transmitted from client to server. The possible values of the method are get and post. And what is the next point here? And the action. The action attribute specifies URL of the web page which process our form details. So a web page should process our form details. That web page address is specified by using with the action attribute. Next one is distinguish between get and post method. So get and post are nothing but the attribute values of method. The first point here is get method is useful in order to get information from the server. So if we want to select some information from the server, then we use this get method. Whereas post method is useful in order to post some data to the server. That means if we want to perform operations like insert operation, delete operation and update operation, we use this post method. Next point here is, when get method is used, then the data is appended to the URL. So let's take, this is our website here, some gmail.com, question mark, uname is equal to some text and password is equal to some text. So whenever we use get method, then the data will be appended to the URL.
Whereas when post method is used, then the data will be placed in the corresponding HTTP body here. When we use GET method, then the data will be placed in the header. Header is nothing but URL. Whereas when post method is used, then the data is placed in the HTTP body. And the next point is, if you want to transmit a small piece of information, then it is better to use GET method, because here the data is appending to the URL. So the size, the maximum size should be 1 MB only. Whereas if you want to transmit a bulky amount of information, then it is better to use post method. Here GET method is insecure. Why? Because the data is appending to the URL, so anybody can watch our data. Whereas post method is secure one. Why? Because here the data is placed in the body, HTTP body, and transmitted to the server. Next question. What is the difference between text field and password field? So text field means some single line text box. Password field means password box. If you use this text field, then what will happen is the characters which we typed will be printed, like alphabets, digits, symbols. Whereas if you use password field, then what will happen is either asterisk symbol or some small solid circles will be printed. So if you want to provide some secure information, it is better to use password text box. If you want to provide some insecure information, it is better to use text field. And the next one is, what is the difference between checkbox and radio button? This is nothing but checkbox. So checkboxes are mainly useful when we have several options and we would like to select multiple options. So select your languages that you know. C, C++, Java, C Sharp, PHP, Perl, Python, likewise. So out of all the available options, we can select multiple options with the help of checkbox. Whereas radio button means we can select only one radio button from the corresponding group. That means the radio buttons which we are created must belonging to the same group. They should belong to the same name. So input type is equal to radio. Name is equal to, let the name here is gender. So likewise, the next radio button name should also be gender here. So likewise, the next radio button name should always be gender here. Then only we can select only one radio button. If each radio button is having its own name, then what will happen is we can select multiple radio buttons also. Here, from the list of radio buttons, we can select only one radio button. So that is the major difference between checkbox and radio button. So what is the difference here? From the list of available options, we can select multiple options from the checkbox. Whereas radio button means from the list of available options, we can select only one radio button. So gender, male, female. So we can select only one option here. And the last question is, what is select? In order to select a single option or multiple options from the list of available options, we can use select control. So select, if you want to select a single option, then use single here. Next, each option in the list is created with the help of option tag element. Option 9, next option 8, close the option tag element. Likewise, we can provide n number of options here. So if we given single as the value here, then only one option will be selected. So what is the first option here? 9. Next 8, 7, 6, likewise all the options will be displayed here. Whereas if we use value as multiple, then we can select multiple options here. If a single option is selected, then it is known as drop down list. If we can select multiple options, then it is called as list box. So drop down list means we can select only one option from the list of available options. Whereas list box means we can select multiple options from the list of available options. So these are nothing but some HTML interview questions or some short options.